Macmillan Audio presents Preventable by Andy Slavitt, read by Bradley Whitford. Preface. In February of 2021, I was at my desk in the old executive office building, a couple of hundred yards from the West Wing. I was 3 weeks into my new role as White House Senior Advisor for the COVID-19 response and starting my fourth Zoom call of the day. Thousands of Americans were dying daily. The country was in desperate need of some good news after the year-long pandemic. A few minutes later, after the call started, my cell phone rang from an unlisted DC number. I hadn't been through an uninterrupted call in the last 3 weeks. I silenced it. My phone rang again. This time I picked it up. It was the president's assistant asking if I could come to the Oval Office for a meeting already in progress. I grabbed a notebook and half jogged to the Oval, where I found President Joe Biden, his chief of staff, Ron Klain, and Jeff Zients, the COVID-19 response czar, in the adjoining dining room. Biden motioned for me to join them at the table. "Tell me what's going on in a way a junior in high school would understand it," he said to the three of us. The global pandemic had been gutting the country for the past year, upending and ending lives, shutting down businesses and causing job losses, and sparking a national identity crisis for a nation that considered itself above many of the world's problems. Biden's promise to the American people to lead us out of the pandemic was one of the reasons he was sitting there. Helping deliver on that promise was the reason I was there as well. Ron, Jeff, and I told him that for many of the questions the public wanted answers to, like when the pandemic would be over, the answers were as yet unknowable. We had estimates, plans, and models, but that was all they were. And after a year of the Trump administration promising that the pandemic was about to end at any moment, the public had grown fatigued and distrustful. "We don't know" is a perfectly acceptable answer, the president said. "Let's give it to the people straight." With nearly 500,000 American lives already lost, 20% of the world's deaths from COVID-19, though we only had 4% of the world's population, he said he wasn't interested in what made him look good, just straight facts he could communicate to the public. No games, just the truth. This was another reason President Biden was sitting there. His sensibility was 180 degrees from that of his predecessor, Donald Trump. I had spent the past year watching the pandemic ravage the country from an unusual seat, on the phone with the Trump team, state officials, scientists, members of Congress, and others at the center of this storm, pushing for actions to improve our response to the crisis. I had become part-time helper, part-time critic, and full-time public chronicler. 7 years before, I'd had my own experience leading a large-scale national rescue effort, first from outside the government, then from inside it. I was one of the few people, and certainly one of the only Democrats, who was talking to the Trump White House on a regular basis during the first year of the pandemic, and I had developed a clear understanding of what was wrong with their response. The White House in 2020 was not led by a man I respected or trusted. At the outset, that hadn't deterred me. After all, the color of your t-shirt shouldn't matter during a global pandemic. But this was the White House of Donald J. Trump, a man whose ego wouldn't allow him to acknowledge a problem like the novel coronavirus emerging on his watch. All the things he would have needed to do, beginning with taking accountability, managing a large-scale response, calling for unity, and relying on experts and institutions of science, were anathema to him. Still, I tried. I contacted Jared Kushner, the president's son-in-law and senior advisor, to offer my assistance, and spent the year on the push and pull of an effort to save lives and prevent even more colossal mistakes. Despite a few successes, when it came to dealing with the White House, I generally found myself fighting the forces of denial, blame, and a short attention span that only blew more life into the pandemic. I put more energy into working with governors, mayors, private companies, and scientists, anyone who needed help or could lend a hand. I also began to publicly document what I was seeing every day, not just for myself, but for the public, in a nightly Twitter tweet storm and in national publications that became a mainstay for many Americans seeking insight into what was happening. I made frequent TV appearances and started a podcast with my bright but bored 18-year-old son, Zach. My views were not formed by what I read in the paper, but from regular conversations with medical providers on the front lines and a whole host of people who would become principal players during the pandemic. People inside the Trump world, like Anthony Fauci, Deborah Birx, and Kushner. Governors in a dozen states, leading pandemic and scientific experts, and organizations that were central, or at least should have been, to defeating the pandemic. I also began to write this book, which I came to call Preventable. This is a story full of missed opportunities, willful neglect, and indifference and denial from our president. But the country's experience during the pandemic is also a culmination of many of the things that had begun to distort our society for a number of years. Gross inequality based on race and income. The growing distrust of expertise. A media addicted to promoting controversy. And a people long out of the habit of shared sacrifice for the common good. So many Americans did not have to die. Some of our mistakes could have been avoided had we had a different and better leader. Others were more deeply rooted in our American identity. Those are more challenging to address and maybe even more important to fix as we move forward. This book is not meant to be full of sage commentary and policy prescriptions. Instead, it follows the stories of some of the key people and events at the center of the crisis. Once you see what I saw, I think the lessons will emerge pretty much on their own. The solutions, well, that's another matter. A few weeks after wrapping up the book, sometime between Christmas and New Year's Day, I received a call from the Biden team asking me to join the White House to help lead the pandemic response in the new administration. The crisis was raging, and the newly authorized vaccine rollout was in trouble. Meanwhile, the normal transition of government was being hobbled by Trump's refusal to acknowledge the election results and his attempt to overturn them. Given the gravity of the challenge, I decided to say yes. It wasn't the first time I had been asked to help the country through a dire situation with an uncertain outcome. A quick digression will help explain how I came to be involved in this story. In many ways, my career has been dominated by a series of blind leaps of faith. In 1998, I was 5 years out of Harvard Business School, newly married, and leading a charmed existence. In January, however, my college roommate and close friend, Jeff Yurkowski, began experiencing numbness in his arm. We were both 31. He was soon diagnosed with inoperable brain cancer. 5 months later, on July 2nd, he passed away, leaving behind not just his friends, but his young wife, Lynn, and year-old twins, Josh and Judy. It wasn't actually what happened while Jeff was alive, but what took place after he died that drove me to leave a fairly typical post-MBA career path and embark on what has become a decades-long journey to improve our system of healthcare. Still in shock and struggling, Lynn moved with the twins across the country to live with my wife, Lana, and me, and our new baby son, Caleb, in our California home. Wherever she went, medical debt collectors followed her. Jeff's fight for his life had meant costly medical care that wasn't always in-network or covered by his insurance. After many phone calls and appeals to hospitals, doctors, and labs, we helped her avoid bankruptcy, but only narrowly. And so in 1999, disturbed by Lynn's experience with medical debt, I started a business to help other uninsured and underinsured Americans avoid the same fate. This was well before the Affordable Care Act, ACA, also known as Obamacare, and in a time when uncovered health care expenses drove hundreds of thousands of Americans into personal bankruptcy every year. Obamacare passed in 2010 with the promise to bring affordable health coverage to millions of Americans who had been left on the sidelines. In October 2013, however, the launch of its healthcare.gov website publicly and spectacularly crashed, threatening to end Obamacare before it got started. Millions of Americans were in limbo. By this time, I had worked in healthcare for over a decade, leading larger and larger healthcare organizations. So I cold called the Obama administration and offered to bring a team to DC to help out. To my surprise, they accepted, most likely because they had no other offers. On October 24th, 2013, I traveled to DC to lead the rescue effort to save the health insurance exchanges and the program itself. This was my second big leap into an unknown abyss, this time with healthcare for millions and a presidency itself at stake. My hope was to give Obamacare a fighting chance to close some of the major healthcare gaps that exist in our country. After 5 weeks of constant work and crisis management, our team managed to do the nearly impossible, and Obamacare was up and running. As the years passed, the value of that work became evident. By 2016, 20 million more Americans finally had access to health insurance, something that changed many people's lives for the better. With Obamacare back on track, I took another leap and left my job in corporate America to lead the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services, a federal agency responsible for overseeing the health care of more than 130 million Americans, most of them living on fixed or low incomes. I rented an apartment within walking distance of the Health and Human Services Department and commuted back and forth each week from Minneapolis, where Lana and I were living with our two teenage sons, Caleb and Zach. The work was tremendously fulfilling. Each day, I had the opportunity to respond to people's problems and make decisions that improved the lives of millions of people. I also got a crash course in Washington 101, spending a significant amount of my time defending Obamacare in hearings held by a Republican-controlled Congress hell-bent on tearing it down. In 2017, after Donald Trump became president and I left government, I envisioned returning home to a quiet, private existence. But when Trump and his allies in Congress made dismantling Obamacare a priority, I abandoned my plans and instead barnstormed the country, rallying Americans to push their members of Congress to vote against repealing the law. I held town halls in red and purple districts, inviting Republican members of Congress who had voted in the past to repeal Obamacare to join me in hearing from their constituents. None of them ever did, but tens of thousands of their constituents showed up to share stories of how the ACA had improved their lives and ask what they could do to save it. That spring and summer changed me. I became something of an outsider's insider, comfortable walking the halls of power in DC, but with a growing understanding of how much power there was in the voice of the people and their stories. This book benefited not only from what came before I wrote it, but rather unusually, also what happened afterward. In early 2021, after submitting the final manuscript, working out of the White House every day, I got the rare opportunity to walk the same halls as the people I'd written about and to ask myself how true my telling was. The publisher invited me to reread every word. Doing the work, after all, offers an entirely different perspective from seeing it from the outside. Now I was no longer in the cheap seats, but in the hot seat myself, with a chance to see if I would need to eat any of my words. Would my perspective on the events of the first year look different once the weight of responsibility fell on my shoulders? I was serving in a very different administration, led by a very different president. But I got a chance to see the scars and successes of our COVID-19 response from up close. I interacted with many of the people I had written about in this book. many of the things I was most critical of the Trump administration for, not playing it straight with the American public, avoiding accountability, discarding science, playing politics, and ignoring the consequences of their actions and the lives lost, I was now on the hook for myself. And I became part of a team trying not only to defeat the pandemic, but also to restore the parts of our government that had been decimated by the prior administration. At first, I felt a deep weight of responsibility, unlike anything I had ever felt before. By January 20th, 2021, the first day of the new administration, people were dying by the thousands every day. New variants of the virus were emerging, and the vaccine rollout was a mess. But I also felt something different, something quite comforting. The presence of a committed president and people all around me in government who were competent and capable and whom I could trust to go fast and respond with urgency. All of these events led me to believe in the themes in this book even more strongly than when I first wrote it. Both the huge missed opportunity to prevent such an enormous loss of life and the rays of hope that are there if we learn our lessons. I hope that as you listen to this book, you will experience the roller coaster of what the first year of the pandemic felt like without the fear that was present at the time. And I hope it will spur in you a newfound commitment to resolving our country's biggest problems together with the many people who wake up every day and work on our behalf. Introduction. One day in April 2020, Ahmed Aden returned home from his warehouse job in Shakopee, Minnesota. He was shaking, sweating through his shirt, and coughing. He and his wife, Safia, feared the worst. For 3 weeks, Minnesota had been under a stay-at-home order due to the COVID-19 outbreak, but Ahmed was an essential worker and unable to work from home. At work, he was busier than ever, scanning and loading packages of necessities and diversions to be delivered to customers who were isolating at home. For the next few weeks, Ahmed was confined to one of the two bedrooms in their apartment, while Safia squeezed in with their 5 children. Like a number of others with COVID-19, Ahmed couldn't afford medical care, and after 2 weeks was no longer getting paid. In April 2020, no tests for COVID-19 were available for Ahmed or his family, owing to a nationwide shortage, as well as a behind-the-scenes dispute between the state of Minnesota and test suppliers over how much money the suppliers would be paid. Despite working for Amazon, one of the world's most valuable companies, which was experiencing a huge surge in orders to make staying at home more comfortable for its customers, without a test, Ahmed didn't qualify for additional paid sick time. Ahmed was isolated, but far from alone. Around the country, thousands and then millions of others found themselves in a similar boat, many in communities that were out of the public eye and which received little support when the virus hit. About a month before Ahmed's infection, I sat in bed reviewing charts and emails from scientists who had an early understanding of how COVID-19 was spreading in Wuhan, China, and Lombardy, Italy. Their concern had grown, as had mine. Starting in February, I had gone on TV and written a piece for USA Today, saying that the country needed to act quickly to avoid disaster. I was hardly the only one. That day, March 12th, the president downplayed the coronavirus entirely, as he had been doing for weeks, and assured the nation that the virus will not have a chance against us. I responded on Twitter, "This will be recorded as a major preventable public health disaster." That tweet was viewed more than 10 million times. I'm trying not to say went viral anymore. As sometimes happens on social media, not everyone agreed. There were only 50 Americans dead from the virus that day. Within 3 months, 100,000 Americans would die. March 2020 began a period unlike any the United States had ever seen. Unlike much of the world, Americans had almost no experience dealing with a public health crisis.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.